Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, thank you all for coming here today and for celebrating with us God's gift of marriage and family life. I would like to compare family life to an airplane travel. Consider this. Before the plane takes off, the pilots have a flight plan. They know exactly where they are going and start off according to their plan. But during the course of the flight, wind, rain, turbulence, air traffic, human error, and other factors act upon the plan. They move it slightly in different directions so that most of the time that plane is not even on the prescribed flight path. Throughout the entire trip, there are slight deviations from the flight plan. Weather systems or unusually heavy air traffic may even cause some major deviations. But barring anything too major, the plane will arrive at its destination. I think it would be fair to say that good families, even great families, are oftentimes off track. The key is that they have a sense of destination. They know what the tracks look like, and they keep coming back to it time and time again. Now, how does this happen? During the flight, the pilots receive constant feedback. They receive information from instruments that read environment, from control towers, from other airplanes, and sometimes even from the stars. And based on that feedback, they make adjustments so that time and time again, they keep returning to the flight plan. The hope lies not in the deviations, but in the vision, the plan, and the ability to get back on track. The flight of that airplane is, I believe, the ideal metaphor for family life. With regard to our families, it doesn't make any difference if we are off target or even if our family is a mess. The hope lies in the vision, in the plan, and in the courage which flows from the sacraments to keep coming back time and time again. Even though the Church makes efforts to encourage returning to family values, the reality is that the trends in the wider society over the last 30 to 50 years have basically shifted from pro-family to anti-family. Over the past 30 years, the situation for families has changed powerfully and dramatically. Consider this. The percentage of families headed by a single parent has more than tripled. The divorce rate The number one health problem for American women today is domestic violence. 4 million women are beaten each year by their partners. According to the Congregational Quarterly, since 1940, the top disciplinary problems in public school have changed from chewing gums and running in hallways to teen pregnancy, rape, and assault. In the midst of all this, the percentage of families with one parent at home with the children during the day has dropped from 66 to 60%. And the average age child spends 7 hours a day watching television and only 5 minutes a day with that. 5 minutes. Think about that. Despite that priority that American culture clearly places on, you know, individual freedom, immediate gratification, efficiency, control, there is literally no role laden with as much joy and satisfaction as the role of rich and interdependent family living. I would suggest that the key of a fulfilling and happy Christian family is in having a destination, a flight plan, and a compass. Jesus addressed the man from today's parable, saying to him, "You fool, you fool." The rich man adds laziness to his greed. He says to himself, "Enjoy yourself." He was complacent. He had a wrong destination. In fact, he had no destination, if you really think about it. So what is our destination? All of us here present would agree that our destination is sharing in the life of the Trinity, which is meant to culminate in heaven, where we will share the life with the three persons of the Holy Trinity. That is why Jesus instituted the church, so that hopefully there will be less fools in the world like that one from the parable. We as Christ Church should have to be obliged to be that compass that points to and educates others about what is important in life and how to reach our destination. I'm not sure how the wedding ceremony was administered when you got married, since there have been a few revisions over the years. However, presently, one of the important parts of the sacramental marriage ceremony is a time when the priest leads the newly joined husband and wife around that table called tetrapod, a type of religious dance celebrating the union, signifying that the newlywed couple has already chosen their common destination, meaning God. And as a newly married couple, they immediately start following their flight plan, following their priest, a church representative who has that compass. We sincerely thank today all of you theologian, one of the Eastern fathers of the church, had to say about marriage. Look at the benefits good marriages bring to humanity. Who are the teachers of wisdom, the discoverers of the deepest knowledge, the explorers of everything on earth, in the sea, or in the sky? Who founded the arts? Who brought together the choirs that sang in churches? Who tamed the ferocity of primitive life? First tilled the soil and crossed the seas? What if not marriage could unite what was divided? Here is a still a better point. We are each other's hand and ear and foot, because marriage doubles our energy, cheers our friends, and depresses our enemies. Sharing our trouble lessens the pain. Joys put in common are sweeter. Harmony makes riches more precious. And marriage is more precious than riches themselves. Amen. Glory to Jesus Christ.
Amen.